We're going to call the May 11th budget hearing meeting together for the Alamance County Commissioners. And first one to speak to us today is Tammy Crawford from Veteran Services. How are you,
Tammy? Hello, good afternoon. This is my first go with this, so if you have any questions, let me know. Bear with me.
All right.
In my budget, everything remained the same with the exception of line item 311. That is my conference regional school training budget. I did ask for an increase of $1,000 on that one. Due to my new employee accreditation, we did have a new employee that started in October. Of course, Ms. Brenda Perry retired, and I took her position, and I hired Shannon Tyler. She was required under new mandated federal regulations to go to training for 12 weeks. One day out of the 12 weeks, she had to go to Clemens. Typically, they go to Clemens. There was a couple times she had to go to Salisbury during that training, so you know we had to absorb those fees. And also there's going to be an increase this coming year. We have two mandated conferences to get our CEUs, and we're going to have an increase for our association fees this upcoming year, and our hotel fees are going to be increased, we were told, at our spring conference. So, and those are required by the federal VA. We each have to maintain 20 hours per year of CEUs, and the new employees have to go through numerous federal background checks. That involves travel to the regional office in Winston-Salem. She'll have to go through a fingerprinting process and an ID badge process, so hopefully that won't take but a couple of trips. With me in the process, I done the process, they lost everything, so I had an extra trip involved, so hopefully they've ironed out all that. I increased that line item, 311, and the other line item I did increase was our daily travel, and that's 312. And that budget line involves regional meetings. We have meetings with the NCDVA, with our district officials. We also use that part of our budget to go out to nursing homes. Sometimes we have to do home visits if our veterans are, you know, incapacitated. We have to meet with district officials from time to time. We've been very limited now because of the administration change to get out, but I definitely want to get that back in place when she gets finished with all her training. She did pass her accreditation test last week and made a 95, so I'm really proud of her. And we also use that for community involvement. We try to stay involved, and we're getting more involved with community agencies. I want to start organizing some meetings with the Durham VA because we have a lot of issues with our veterans here in Alamance County to iron out issues they have there. But it's expensive to get down there and also utilize our time away from the office. So that's something I want to look at, if we have the resources. But that's the only two things I did increase. Everything remained the same. I just want to mention line item 495 is our community project, which is the parade fund. And we did get a very nice donation from ABC Supply of $2,500. Wow. So I let that remain the same because we're, of course, wanting to implement some future things with our parade. We're having our first parade committee meeting this afternoon, so we've got some monies to work with that. But as far as my budget, I've asked for an increase of $1,500 just due to travel, which they've mandated so much more training with our job, which is, you know, actually mandated through the federal VA. So that's it. You guys have any questions for me?
Where are you located now?
We are located diagonally across the street here. Our address is 201 Elm Street.
The old ag building?
Yes, sir.
The old ag building.
I've gotten some complaints from veterans. I know it's not your fault, that it's hard for them to get in.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Because of
the
access?
Steps.
Yeah, I understand. And it is more difficult than our other because we had great access
yeah.
at the other building. And I hear that too. And sometimes parking's difficult, especially if they have a funeral at the church. They,
oh, yeah.
you know, take the parking. Yeah, that we've heard that. And, you know, that's a problem.
Is there a back entrance to that building that could be made accessible, more accessible?
There's one into the meeting room. I don't
yeah.
know if that's used or not.
I don't think so, because we can't even get in that back entrance. There's not even a key entry for us.
Oh, really?
So,
and there's steps. I think the only ramp that we have is in front as well.
But there is a ramp on the front.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
ADA ramp. Okay.
Yeah.
Is it a large enough, excuse me, large enough problem that we need to do something about it? I mean, like build a ramp in the back?
You don't need one in the back.
We were looking at it whenever we do something as far as our facilities plan, that was going to be something that we discussed and put in the mix, as well as making sure that that was the right location, because it is an issue with parking, especially parking when we're having the roof being redone. So we've had a lot of parking issues.
Well, that's been part of it too with the renovations.
Yes,
going
sir.
On.
It's got a side entrance.
Yeah. But we have, you know, again, recently redone the roof. We've updated the bathrooms to handicap accessible. So, and we do have, the ramp was put on the front when we did the facilities plan back in 2009.
Yeah.
Mostly a Canoda building doesn't have any steps at all. You walk right in. Some of us did for years. I was young.
Yeah. Tammy, thank you. Any more questions, guys? All right.
Thank you.
Quick question.
Sure.
You said you had some donations.
Yes, sir.
You keep that in a separate account from this, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. You don't give it to the county?
Can't,
and,
can't
no, that's strictly for our parade fund.
They have a night that Brenda started this, 3 years ago?
This will be our third year.
Well, third year this year, so 2 years ago. And it's been a real success.
It's been a wonderful,
a lot of participation.
Wonderful thing.
The veterans really enjoy being a part of it.
And so. It's growing. I mean, it's unbelievable. We've gotten calls the day after the parade. We want to be there next year.
That's wonderful.
That's good.
Thank you.
All right. Next up, Mr. Inspections, Robert Keith.
Good afternoon. Two things. First, I'd like to thank you for your service to the county and the citizens. We appreciate what you do. It's a great responsibility. Second of all, Commissioner Parker, I want to apologize for not getting to meet you before. My wife had a procedure that the afternoon we were supposed to meet with you, so I'm a new face for you, and I apologize for that.
Not a problem. I appreciate it.
Nice okay. to meet you. Yes. Our budget has mostly stayed the same this year as it was last year, with two exceptions. One has to do with a position increase that you all kindly approved mid-year. We got one extra inspector. If you look on page 9, our revenues are up significantly because, you know, the building boom is back. So we were granted an extra position, and we have filled that. We now have 6 inspectors. And so if you look at the expenses for vehicles and things, education, that there's quite a bit of that that comes with our positions. Those have all gone up 20% commensurate with the extra inspector. Computer supplies, small tools, automotive supplies, cell phone bill, things of that nature. So that those items were raised 20% to help cover the cost associated with the extra inspector. We are pleading for a vehicle again this year. It's the same as last year. There is one change I had on there, that we were going to add to that capital expenditure money. If you look at page Form 6, we're going to kick in some extra to try to get two.
We don't have those, do we? We don't actually.
They're in a separate section.
They're back in the back.
Okay, well, I have them if you need them, but what we're going to do, we have a vehicle that's actually out of commission right now, so we're short a vehicle. So we're going to, we actually have a proposal next Monday to spend some PM funds to get a vehicle to replace the one. It has a fuel leak that we can't find, and it's not safe, so we've mothballed it. But other than that, the only other thing I'm asking for, if you look at page Form 8, or if you don't have that, I'll just explain it to you. We're asking for a reclassification. Previously, there was an inspection supervisor position. It was not filled because that was still during the downturn when Chris Fawcett left us. We just left that position unfilled. But now with our being as busy as we are, we have a need for that. There is, at the state level, kind of a requirement that we have a QA program where we're kind of checking behind our inspectors to make sure they're being thorough. We don't have that right now because of we don't have an inspection supervisor. So what we're asking for is a reclassification of one of our senior inspectors to an inspection supervisor to help wear a couple of my hats and also do this program where we'll make sure that we're not missing important code violations. And so the total cost for that is estimated to be about $4,500 per year. It's a two-step increase in salary for an existing position. So those are the things that we've asked for, and I'll just add that we try to run it like a business over there. We don't buy things we don't need, and if we need it, we try to find the money and buy it, and we'll try to make do with whatever you give us.
For your information, Roger, they run a balanced budget, something that doesn't happen often in government. You'll notice their projected revenues matches their projected.
Yeah, we're very, very close to being self-sustaining, and that's because our activity is up. Our permit fees are coming in because we just have a lot of projects. Alamance County is building a whole bunch of houses. So, any questions from anyone?
So that job you were describing is really like a team lead.
Yes, it's a supervisor position. Yeah, we have six inspectors now, so I'd like to make one of them. He'll still be an inspector, but he'll spend some of his time, you know, making sure. I have a lot of new inspectors, and we need to make sure that they're not missing something. You know, if they do, we're not going to be mean to them. We're just going to give them a little extra training.
Mr. Chairman, I do want that. We will be using $161,000 in general fund revenue. However, it is down from the 226 from last year. So
on paper, they're pretty good.
On paper, they're looking very, very, very good. So on paper, they're $60,000 less cost to the general fund this year than last year, even with the request.
And that kind of bears out because when we approved the extra position last year, one of the assumptions was that that was going to generate more fees than what it was going to cost to pay for the first year.
So very good.
Thank you.
All right. And they do a good job.
Thanks, sir. Very much so.
Thank you.
All right. Moving right along. Health. Stacy, there she is. She got two spots. Yeah.
Good afternoon. I think the first ones that you all have for us are dental clinic and WIC. Is that correct?
Health
is first. Okay.
It is on this list.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll start with that. And welcome, Mr. Parker. Okay. So for health, just to go over the overall highlights, because it's a big budget. Overall, fiscal year 16-17 expenditures are about 4% less than fiscal year 15-16. Revenues are slightly less than our fiscal year 14-15, but due to Project Launch, which was our large federal grant being sunset in fiscal year 15-16, and so that that reduction in revenue you'll see in the future years, unless we get another big grant.
That was the SAMHSA grant.
That's correct, the big SAMHSA grant that we had for early childhood mental health services, the prevention arm of that. And then the major changes are in particularly personnel. So overall, we have a reduction in salary and fringe line items, mostly due to either freezing or not filling positions or reorganizing our own structure within the health department to maximize our human resources. We are utilizing some temporary contract staff as not to increase our permanent staff load. But you will actually see one request for one position in environmental health for a processing assistant 5. And this, in the past, this was shared with inspections as a processing assistant, half-time going to inspections and half-time coming to environmental health. And in January of 2016, inspections required that full position to be used in inspections because of the work that they were doing. And when, you probably know this better than most, that when folks are increasing inspections, that means we're typically increasing environmental health because folks are looking at us for permitting and our own type of inspections with on-site and wastewater. So we are requesting one position to undertake those duties of processing requests, permits from contractors, builders, and private citizens in environmental health. And the additional duties would be to scan the records that we have in environmental health in an effort to get us to an electronic base in environmental health where contractors, builders, private citizens, folks in the county can look those records up themselves on a website. That's that.
Would that include septic systems?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that, yes. It's pretty amazing how they can locate your septic fields and put it in GIS, and it's mm-hmm. on a map, and now you have a good record when you go back 10 years later and you're wanting to add on to your house or something. You know, right. Exactly where all the septic fields, lines, and everything, because
we're in a transitional period now from sort of the paper way that folks used to draw out on a piece of paper their estimates about where things were on the land, and now they're using GIS to sort of pinpoint where the well will be, where the septic lines will be, and now the next step is to put that totally online for folks to be able to access.
So this would have come in handy when we were dealing with the complaint
exactly,
that we had.
Exactly, that would have taken part of that issue.
Yes.
It would have been a map there.
Because you were using really old records at that point. Yeah. So that's major changes in personnel. Other major changes in the budget, we are looking at an increase in training and continuing education. Most of you know that public health is an ever-changing discipline, especially now, recently, with Ebola and Zika. It's also important to provide training and education to the public health workforce. We have several newly hired positions, soon-to-be-hired positions, folks who have changed internally or their role has changed internally, and so they require training and education to be able to fulfill the duties. And our existing staff also needs training and education to stay up to date with the emerging issues that we're facing in public health. We also are requesting 2 vehicles for environmental health. Like I said, their workload is steadily increasing as folks are building more and out in the rural areas as well. So when folks decide to build a house out there, we're involved in that piece of it. We are asking to replace their 2 oldest vehicles, a truck and a car, out of their aging fleet. Our environmental health specialists travel to some of the most rural parts of our county, and so it's important for them to have a reliable vehicle. And we are also asking for additional funds for exam beds in our clinical area. So we also, in addition to aging vehicles, we have aging medical equipment, and we have an increase in patients meeting the criteria of obese, and our existing medical equipment, i.e. our beds, may pose a safety and liability issue if they're not able to handle the weight of a patient. So we're asking for that as major changes. And then the last major change we have is in overall sort of supplies. There's an increase in medical supplies, and that's the nature of the cost of medical supplies over time. Also, an increase for scientific devices, including the GPS devices that Commissioner Boswell just mentioned for environmental health to be able to meet their duties, and emergency bags in our clinic areas so that if we have a medical emergency that happens within our clinic. And you also notice an an increase in utilities, which is just the nature of the utility market at this time. It's been trending up for a while. So those are the major changes in our health budget. And on the revenue side, you'll see that, like I said, that slight decrease that is attributed to us no longer having the project launch monies. Any questions about the health budget?
Just the way way you keep the books on this. Under other programs down where it says infant mortality reduction, and it's 113K.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain me what creates the 113K?
Sure. So I think I don't have the same thing that you all are looking at, but what I think you're looking at is our revenue side. And so we get different types of funding, not only from the county. You all give generous to your public health department, and we are very thankful for that. But we also get funding from the state and federal. And so what you're looking at with that $113,750, I believe it is, mm-hmm. is from a state allocation that we received for infant mortality reduction. So we have folks working in the health department. They're looking at strategies to help babies be born healthy and stay healthy throughout the first year of their life and beyond. So that's a state allocation from the North Carolina Division of Public Health that I believe was approved by the commissioners this fiscal year just a couple months ago, and then we'll receive a second allocation in the new fiscal year.
It's showing up in both the expense and the revenues.
Right. Oh, that's what I was wondering. It's got an offset.
Oh, yes.
Offset. Okay.
Because we have to spend that completely.
But we haven't gotten that before, is that?
We had not gotten that before this fiscal year in 15-16. And the state sort of rearranged their maternal block grant. And so instead of giving every county a certain amount, they redistributed those funds to the counties that had the highest, the 25 counties that had the highest infant mortality rate, and we were number 25.
That's
so,
not really. Good, but
not great for us, but also kind of works in our favor. And so we're working to use that money for different strategies in our community.
And what kind of reporting back do you have to do on that?
We have an agreement addended with the state, so which is essentially sort of like a contract
they
with the division of
move up.
That's
right.
They set certain standards and deliverables that we must meet, and then we have to report back to them on those.
Now, this is not a lot of money, but there was about a 13K increase in the training expense, which mm-hmm. you were talking about a while ago.
Yes, sir.
Line. Were those due to an unexpected requirement that you had to have, or
certification
from budget to budget? Why would that?
So some of those things are mandated trainings that we have to do either through the Division of Public Health through their agreement addenda. So like our CD coordinator has to attend a CD conference, those sort of things. So we have some mandated trainings and education that has to happen. A lot of what you're seeing is also that we have a lot of new staff, particularly in environmental health, who require a lot of training to get their authorization
okay,
to be able to.
That would be a headcount driven thing. That's why that, I mean, new
yes.
headcount.
New hire.
Getting
yes.
certified in
right.
different areas.
Yep.
Okay.
New folks coming in. And with the, like I said, with the advent of emerging issues like Ebola and Zika, that's not necessarily something a local health department has always been trained in, so we all have to get trained in those sort of things and keep going. So, good question.
So that's regulation.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was just curious.
Yeah.
Not a lot of money.
Driven by new regulations.
Can't have enough of that.
All right. Any more questions on that?
Nope.
How about the WIC and dental?
Okay. Do you have a preference as to which one we start with? You tell me.
It doesn't matter which. Let's do it. Oh, as WIC on page, our book is 69.
Okay. So WIC, Women's Infant and Children program, is a supplemental food and nutrition counseling program that is 100% federally funded. There are no state or county dollars that come into this program, so we administer this program for the federal government. So when you look at this budget, this one's going to be sort of an easy one to get through. And in this upcoming fiscal year, the federal funding has been reduced by another about 5%. So this program is now operating on a budget that is 5% reduced from last year's. And so really, most of the changes of what you're seeing in your packet are reflective of us rearranging positions and freezing positions to accommodate that 5%. Reduction without hindering the quality of care that we give to our patients and the scheduling and appointments that we're able to give to the patients. So that's the bulk of what you're seeing. There's very little change in the rest of the budget.
Except utilities, and I know the state went over.
Yeah.
They hit us no matter who you are, right?
Yes.
Any more questions? Any questions on that?
Well, it looks like there's a little bit coming out of our general fund, $8,300.
Actually, what that is right now, Commissioner Byrd, is they have revenues in excess of, revenues are in excess of general, of their expenses. So what we will do is through the, if there is able to have a cost of living adjustment, we will true those up for the final manager's recommended budget.
Thank you.
Any other questions about WIC?
Tell us about the dental care.
And so the Children's Dental Clinic is also a bit unique in that no county appropriated tax dollars are used to fund this clinic. They fund their clinic through the revenues they make through seeing children in the dental clinic. The biggest changes here, you know, salaries are always, personnel is always what it is, but also you'll see bigger changes in the professional services line item, and this is to reinstate the use of UNC Dental School of Dentistry residents to see patients. That's a cost-saving type of thing instead of contracting with another dentist, which is much more expensive. This allows us to see more patients at a lower cost and allows UNC dentistry students to get education, and we get quality dental care for children at a lower cost.
So are we having an offsetting reduction?
Well, what they cut that in the last budget. Remember, so they're an agency or a department that they make their revenue and they expend. So they're budget neutral. They don't use any county tax dollars to offset their budget at all. So last year they cut that service as they were seeing that they were not meeting their revenue.
Okay.
So they are reinstating that service this year.
So I do see general revenues.
This is one that we will true up through the manager's recommended budget.
Okay.
And for the most part, the rest of their budget looks about the same.
So all of all three of these budgets have gone before your Board of Health.
That's correct. All three of these budgets have gone through the Board of Health and now come to you for your review and to be included in the county budget.
Are the dentists that come here, are they senior when that's doing the work?
The residents?
Yeah, right.
They're in their residency at UNC School of Dentistry. I'm not sure if there's a year that's applied to that. So they've already gone through the bulk of their training and are now practicing residents at that point.
When they come, do they bring their teachers, to oversee their work?
No, they. Our staff are used as preceptors.
Them. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's correct.
That's nice. Just extra hands. And
mutual benefit for the community. They learn from our experienced staff, and we're benefiting from that as well.
And how many dentists do we have on our staff?
We have two dentists on staff.
Plus they're bringing the latest.
Yes.
You know, what
new technologies, new strategies, evidence-based types of things. That's right. Yes, sir.
Both learn.
That's right. Yes, they do teach us a little bit as well.
We're one of how many counties in the state to have the dental program?
Oh, that's a great question. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to answer that right off the top of my head, but I know two of them just.
Only two or three.
Yeah, I think there are only a few left, and many of them aren't free sort of standing is what I call freestanding, where they make their own revenue and don't use any tax dollars from the county. There are only a few.
It's a great program.
Yeah.
Really is Orange doing it?
Orange still has their dental.
Yeah, I worked in it.
Yep. They still have their dental clinic intact.
Well, okay. Very
thank
good.
You very
any
much.
Other questions?
No more questions? We'll
thank you all.
Send you on back to work.
Thank you.
All right. Ms. Susan. Come on up here.
So I'm going to just give you, so to put $22 million in a one-pager, there you go.
Summary of $22 million.
Always
right.
My attempt was to put it in a one-pager. So just to summarize where we are, as you know, DSS provides 28 of the state mandated programs, state and federal, that are required by general statute. And then we have some optional programs, fraud investigations. We do strongly in Alamance County, and we have a full-time FTE appropriated to that. That could be put into every one of our economic service workers, but it would fall behind the eight ball, so we actually pull that out, and we have a full-time investigator. Family Justice Center, our domestic violence, male batterers treatment, or some of the other optional non-mandated programs that we offer. So you can see from the line item information you have in your book that our proposed expenditures are $22,133,000. We have a lot of federal and state revenues, so you can't, it would be difficult to look at our budget just from an expenditure side. We're offset by about two-thirds in federal and state revenues. So the number in the center of that one pager, $6,410,000, is what our county dollar appropriation is. That is an increase over last year of less than 1%. And the $57,000 really is for a voiceover IP that MIS asked us to include, which is important, but other than that, we would have been flat. Yes.
So that number doesn't correspond to a number in this book.
You're talking about the 22 numbers you put?
Well, that one and the $6,410,000.
Well, so after it leaves us, they put things in like insurance and stuff like that. So we
other costs.
When it was prepared for the DSS board, these were our numbers. But we don't have any input into whether insurance is going up or personnel cost or any of that. So that was our number.
A little value add there.
Value added. Right. Right. So I do want to highlight just a couple of things that are increases in this budget. So we are proposing three new positions in economic services. We've been doing overtime in that area for 2 years now, mandatory overtime with our staff. About 65 staff have been doing 4 hours a week mandatory overtime to keep up with the demand for NCFAS food and nutrition services and Medicaid applications. On a month-to-month basis, those overtime hours paid at time and a half add up to anywhere between 4 to 8 workers overall. So we're proposing to add 3 new workers, 2 in Medicaid and 1 in food and nutrition, to try to be able to do away with mandatory overtime. We don't know if that's going to absorb all of it, but that's our hope. And we want to give 3 workers a try. Plus, we don't have space for any more.
So it should be budget neutral, or at the least.
Yes, yeah. It should be actually a
right,
little bit under.
To our favor.
Right. And those Medicaid workers receive 75% reimbursement, the food stamp 50%. So, so you take that and the overtime at time and a half, and you come out budget neutral for all said purposes. We're asking to add an additional guardianship worker. And if you remember, the sheriff talked about the increase in adult protective services in that area. So we normally receive about 15 new guardians a year, and in the first 7 months of this year received 35 new guardians. That's a caseload, and we need another social worker in that area, and that was just in the first 7 months, and that's growing, and part of that is mental health. You know, young folks who have been determined incompetent, and their families are just worn out with them and just refusing to respond, and so they're younger. You know, it's not unusual for us to have a lot of 25, 26 year old folks that we're become guardian of with very complex needs, in addition to 40 or 50 year olds, and then the elderly folks that we normally traditionally have been our guardians.
Why do you look at me? me when you say
that. I did not. Did not. If I did, it was just because you know the tribulations over the years with our guardianship services.
That's quick.
That's right.
That was a good answer.
Well, and last year, the General Assembly removed the Health Department and the LMEs from having any responsibility in public guardianship. So all those come to social services now without any additional funding. So the other increase in our budget is an increase in our foster care line item, and that pays for room and board for foster care. Our numbers of kids in foster care are up. I think we can attribute that to prescription drugs, substance abuse, those issues, along with domestic violence. But we're on track to spend over $1 million this year in actual foster care budget. It used to be about $650,000 in 13-14. We get some reimbursement, but our county costs are going to go up there. So that line item is increased.
I missed it, Susan, but the $6,410,000,
yes,
is how much increase is that over last year?
Less than 1%.
Oh, okay.
That's the line.
Absorbing those new positions and the foster care increase with some additional revenue from the positions and cutting out that overtime, mm-hmm, some of those things.
So when the money that we pay out for foster care, that's going to foster parents and their expenses of taking care of the foster kids?
Foster parents, group homes, yes.
Just getting them placed and doing,
yes,
what you have to do with foster.
Yes, and I'll tell you, we have about $70,000 in cost over the last 16 months, about a year and a half, of where we can't get them authorized through mental health, that we're paying county dollars, all county dollars, for their cost of care, when normally they'd be covered by Medicaid once they're authorized through the mental health process.
What's the problem with that?
It's very, very complex. It's the availability of beds, it's the providers, it's the process, it's their decisions to step down medically necessary, but nothing being available to step down to, and so so the facility says come get them, and if there's no place to put them, then we have to continue to pay for them to be there at county dollars until we can find appropriate, safe.
What is your opinion as to the relationship between all of these problems with children and the one-parent families that we are just being overwhelmed with now?
Well, I mean, anybody who's a parent knows how difficult it is just to even make it in today's world with two parents, so it's complicated. One of the big issues is income, and with just one income to help out families, you're behind the eight ball. And so having adequate resources to take care of your child's needs early is compounding into long-term problems for these children growing up.
It's substantial, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Well, and a poverty issue has to play into that.
Well, it is poverty. It's the one-parent income.
Right. And while I'm working other jobs, second shift jobs.
That's right.
Question a lot of times. So they can get a job. They can't because who's going to watch the children when they go get a job?
Well, and then factored into all of that, I think, is it's educational success. And, it's difficult for a child to exceed requirements and succeed in school without the family being a part of that. And if a parent's working two jobs or if they're living in a car as a result of poverty, mm-hmm, then kids aren't getting, they aren't getting the support they need.
I think you're right, though, David. It is
a
big thing.
It is. Yeah. It is. It's significant. Yes, sir.
Yep.
So that's the DSS budget. Prior to these ladies putting their numbers with it, we were less than 1%.
Now you're about to put,
Yeah, I haven't seen the numbers you've seen yet. So I'll be glad to answer any questions. It's a complex budget.
Well, I wanted to ask a comparative question.
Okay.
You have such a large budget. How would you compare your agency with other social service agencies of counties of similar size to us in North Carolina? Are there standards or comparative data that you can kind of shore up to?
So there aren't standards. It used to be the Department of Commerce put out a per capita per capita staffing for county departments, but I haven't seen that in a couple of years. We used to be very lean on that. And so, for example, I'll give you one of my peer folks who, I won't mention the county, because he probably wouldn't appreciate that. But, you know, 90,000 compared to our 150, and his DSS is staffed over 240, and we're at 203.
So we look pretty good.
I think we're lean, but it's hard to be apples to apples because some have child support, some don't. We have the third highest number of family care homes in Alamance County, and so we have more family care home monitors, and some counties only have one or two, so it's only part of one job, so it's really difficult. You know, child support's privatized in some counties. In some counties, it's in the tax department in Guilford, so it's hard to analyze. Some folks contract their attorneys. We have on staff, so it's difficult. But I'd say we're lean. You wouldn't expect me to say anything else.
I don't mind saying our director is probably the best in the state.
I have to agree with you, sir.
I wouldn't doubt it. I don't know very many.
I think she is.
I do know Susan.
Thank you.
I agree. Well,
thank you.
Yeah, so, I came from Orange County.
There you go.
You agree, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you definitely agree, man. Don't you?
Yeah.
Any other questions I can answer for you?
That's good.
Okay, if you need to come up, don't hesitate in letting us know.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, now, the grants.
That's me.
I didn't want you to run too far.
Yeah, right? Well.
Maybe I better
kind of pump you up.
No, sir. That's another reason we keep our numbers so low. We actually have, and let me find that. Here we go. So we only have, two Governor's Crime Commission grants at the Family Justice Center that will go forward July, August, and September. They're on a federal fiscal year. So we have some carryover funding. One of those is the Court Navigator grant, and that's the one that coordinates hiring volunteers like the Guardian Ad Litem program to work with victims of domestic violence through the process of a 50B and getting services. So that's our 5350 line. Then we have the Legal Assistance Program, which is another Governor's Crime Commission grant that pays for attorneys to help domestic violence victims get custody in cases where they need to be granted custody. So both, that's 5360. Both those grants will end on October 1st. We have applied for, but not received notification yet, another Family Justice Center grant through the Governor's Crime Commission for right at $300,000 that will focus on, will continue the Court Navigator program, and then we'll focus on other better victim-centered care. It'll provide some security measures for the Family Justice Center, some improvements around security, a centralized triage, and that's once again 100% funded, so expenditures and revenue match. So we should know about that one very soon. And then we've applied for Office of Violence Against Women federal grant to work with elderly folks who have been neglected and exploited but would be screened out through the regular Adult Protective Services process. And that would provide a case manager out of the Family Justice Center to help with family violence around elder abuse. And we should hear about that grant in late September, and it would start October 1st. So those are the two grants that we've applied for that are pending, and two that we'll finish up.
That's another thing.
Both 100%
funded.
Susan
does well as grants. She works on those and pushes those very hard.
She'll be in front of you at our next meeting as well to talk about our mental health diversion grant with the Department of Justice. And just want to publicly, you know, again, follow up what David said. Susan has really stepped up on the mental health issue, not like she has anything else to do, but she has really taken the leadership role on this and working with the sheriff, and I just want to publicly thank Susan for the job she does.
Well, this is a significant area that affects our community, but it affects DSS.
And she's looking at me again when we talk about
it. No, I was just thinking about...
She talked age, now she's talking about...
No, Dave, Commissioner Smith, I was just thinking about how you mentioned single parents. These are issues, the incarceration and mental illness. All these major well-being factors really affect our community, and they affect our services at Social Services, and our services as a county. So they're important.
Thank you, Sue.
Thank you. And I wouldn't be able to do the work I do without my staff.
I know,
you are phenomenal.
Fine people there. Very good.
Thank you.
If you guys want, we can go ahead and take a break, come back at...
Let's take Greg and Susan, maybe.
Okay, well, that's good. I'm good with that.
Yeah.
Just checking. Susan, you want to go ahead and bring our debt service up to date?
I'll be glad to.
Tell us where we are, and we'll decide then what we need to do.
Additional handout for you. Thank you. Okay, our debt service overall is going down 3.8%. Excluding the animal shelter, of the $250,000 that we are estimating, we will have principal payments in the amount of $6,967,605 and interest in the amount of $2,348,583. It gives you a breakdown of what we will be spending for our school system as well as ACC at the top through our general obligation bonds. Total bonds would be $48.2 million, and that does include the $15 million that we are anticipating to issue for Alamance Community College. The new issue date for that will be in July. Also with that, you'll see the section other than bonds, where the county takes out installment purchases. They're a shorter period of time. General obligation bonds are for 20 years. Other than bonds normally have a typical less than 10-year life. So we will be expiring one loan for the 800 megahertz system, which we used for Viper for the central communications. So we will be retiring that debt, and other than bonds will have an expense total outstanding of $9.4 million at the end of next fiscal year for 17. In addition to that cover page, I gave you some statistical information as far as where Alamance County's debt is in relation to our peer group, as well as overall throughout the state. For populations of 100,000 to 249,999, as of June 30th, 2015, and this information came from the state treasurer's website. So for last fiscal year, we were ranked amongst our peers, we were ranked 16th in having outstanding debt of $72,169,560. That did include the $15 million for ACC, which had been authorized but had not been issued.
Does include?
It does include, yes, sir. Overall, throughout the state, we are ranked 32nd. The next two sheets that you have in behind that kind of give our ratios for total outstanding debt compared to our property valuation. Our overall property valuation is $12.6 billion. So when you take our outstanding debt of the $72 million and divide it by that, our ratio to debt is 0.569%, which means we are 17th among our peers, and overall we are ranked 55th in the state.
So that's kind of more in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
It's better to be ranked higher, right, than lower.
Well, if being lower means that we are carrying lower debt as compared to our
property
values. The higher that ratio...
Lower is better.
Right, lower is better. So the lower number we are, the better we are. Because if you look at the first county that's ranked as Harnett County, mm-hmm. they're carrying a substantial amount of debt compared to their valuation.
So, the term lower, does that mean lower on the page or a lower number? Because 55 is 55 lower than 50 or higher than 50?
It would be lower than 50 because we would be carrying.
So lower on the page.
Lower on the page, correct. So the lower that number, the less debt we are carrying as compared to the ones that are at the higher numbers.
Higher on the page.
Higher on the page.
Not the higher ranking.
Higher on the page. And then the last.
I don't mean to confuse
everybody. Yeah, I think we're all confused.
Sorry.
The last statistic that I gave you is what that equates out to our population. So for our citizens, we are ranked 17th amongst our peers of per capita debt of $463. Overall, statewide, we are ranked 60th. So that means we are carrying a lower debt burden for our citizens than the ones who are listed above us.
Per person.
Per person, yes.
So we're doing well.
We are doing a great job.
All right.
And even with us having the 15 million, these numbers take that into consideration because the state treasurer was looking at what had also been authorized but yet unissued. So that does include for
so
where we are with ACC.
Of our new
yes,
debt
that is.
Service coming.
Yes, sir.
Up.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So if anyone has any questions concerning the debt service.
So if the school system comes up with an idea about building a lot of school buildings.
Yes.
A lot of money.
That would change quickly.
That
right?
would change very quickly.
That would be very. So these rankings would be very sensitive to.
Correct.
What we do with this ABSS.
Absolutely.
Unless we retire some other debt before that happens.
Right. And right now we are retiring debt at around $7.2 million a year. So we, and that's not including the interest that we're paying. That is just the principal amounts. So we have retired debt very quickly. We've been able to meet our payments and make our payments. So that's been a great asset to our citizens. So if there is a case in the future where we need to issue another bond or have an installment purchase for vehicles or voting equipment or building repairs, we have that liquidity and that ability to issue those as well.
Very good. Any more questions, mm-hmm. comments?
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome.
All right. Greg Thomas.
This will be Greg's last.
No, we're not allowing that.
This
I'm sorry.
Greg's last budget. So.
This is somewhat bittersweet for me.
Yeah, well.
I've had a marvelous run with this county. Let me say on the front end, Commissioner Parker, I apologize for not being here last week for the meet and greet session with you. But the landfill does stand ready to answer any questions that you might have.
It was a very good presentation. That we're good for another few hundred years on the rest of something.
We're good for a while.
If you want a tour, go down, Greg, and give you a tour of the facility itself. Do a good job out there.
Thank you so much. The year 2016 will mark the 22nd anniversary of the Austin Court landfill opening. The landfill is one of 41 municipal solid waste landfills in North Carolina, and it is the only municipal solid waste landfill permitted to operate in Alamance County. The landfill has enjoyed a long and rich history with a solid track record of being effective as both a solid waste manager and a budget and finance manager, and I'm very fortunate to have been a part of that. The current landfill operation remains steady and slightly increasing with 82,000 tons of solid waste per year. This will account for the lion's share of the landfill's budget revenue. The landfill's total budget request for the upcoming year is $4,491,397. The operational expenses represent a nominal increase of about 6%. For the past 5 years, the landfill revenue at year's end fiscal year's end has exceeded expense by an average of more than $800,000, thus contributing to a stable retained earnings account dedicated to future landfill construction, closure and post-closure future costs, and equipment purchases. The local landfill tipping fee, local fee of $36 has remained unchanged for the past 13 years. There was a $2 per ton estate tax imposed in 2008, as Commissioner Smith would remember. But there continues to be no local tax dollars in the landfill budget. The operational increase is primarily due to a request to increase a part-time landfill attendant to a full-time attendant. I'm having very, it's been a difficult time trying to find attendance in general, and part-time it's almost been impossible. Have not had a really a full staff, trained staff, in well over 2 years. So that's been a challenge. Also, I have included a request to add a landfill assistant director of operations. I want to talk a little bit about that. This position would help to strengthen and provide much needed support to a successful yet challenging landfill operation. Essentially, this position would work directly with and supervise the heavy equipment operator superintendent and the solid waste specialist who oversees the convenience centers in our county and recycling services. The landfill assistant director of operations would report directly to and work closely with the solid waste director and be responsible for coordinating the design, regulatory, and compliance requirements in accordance with the state regulations associated with the comprehensive solid waste program. Additionally, permit obligations, well and leachate monitoring, as well as implementing engineered plans under state permits would also be assigned to this position. In lieu of my retirement, I would recommend, just to recommend, that the new director would look at this position for maybe up to a year so as to assess the need, and they may look at things a little differently. So I would, and I don't know that I've shared this with Mr. Honeycutt, but that would be what I would do for that position. This budget proposal includes capital outlay request to purchase a new 120,000-pound trash compactor at a cost of $975,000. This machine directly contributes to the overall longevity of the landfill, which now stands at more than 75 years. Also included is a new heavy equipment shop building. I've got at a cost, we recently received bids for this. The low bid was $303,000. That's in the last 2 weeks. I'd hope to get this to the board and in the next 30 days to recommend. This was included in our current budget, but due to the wet winter months, we would like to carry this into our next year's budget, although I think we can get the bids to the board certainly in June. We have adequate monies to support this building. It is for the mechanical repair of bulldozers and heavy equipment and things of that nature. It is a normal and natural progression, we feel, to our landfill. So that is included. It's in our current budget, but I've included it in our next budget. That's part of that. Also included in capital expenses is a total of $144,850 in paving projects, a 53-foot trailer, a baler conveyor, three open-top dumpsters, and an attendance booth. Most of these are normal recurring expenses in our landfill budget. Excuse me. As I mentioned earlier, the lifespan of the Austin Quarter landfill is now projected to extend beyond 75 years. This compares favorably to the 40-year life projected in 2007. A strong contributing factor to this doubling of lifespan has been our ability to achieve higher compaction rates made possible through our ability to invest in new and more advanced equipment. So, having said all this, our current budget is $3,674,116. And our requested budget is $4,491,397. This equates to an increase of $817,281, or 22%, and is primarily attributed to the increase in capital outlay costs for the upcoming year, and more specifically, the $975,000 trash compactor, which on average is a 5-year investment. The landfill's current fund balance is now more than $21 million, with an unrestricted balance of about $8 million. This is the strongest financial position in the history of the Alamance County landfill, and I believe this budget will continue to provide this stability while meeting the overall goals and objectives as outlined in our mission statement. And I appreciate the opportunity to present this, and I'll be glad to answer questions.
So on the equipment side, a big part of that expenditure is for a compactor, is that
Yes, sir.
What we're looking at. How about other equipment? Any loaders or anything?
Nothing in this budget. No, sir. Okay.
What do you do with the compactor you're using currently? Do you replace it or just now you have...
It will become a secondary. What it does, Commissioner Parker, is it constantly runs over trash to compact trash to increase your density. And that's part of the reason we've extended the life of our landfill is this new equipment that it's not broken down. It's been a tremendous asset to us.
That thing needs to run every day you open.
Yes, sir.
To keep that compaction to a maximum, I guess, is the way to look
yes,
at
sir.
It.
What was the expectancy on the landfill when you took over, Greg?
40 years.
40?
Yes, sir.
Or 75.
Yes, very, very interesting that the landfill's expectancy has not decreased in the last 10 years.
It's absolutely gone up. And that's because of a lot of their innovative
stuff. Because of this man right yes, here sir. Doing his job. And I really, Alamance County really hates to see him.
We do that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity that you awarded me about 10 years ago.
One of the better decisions I made.
I doubt I'll be here when they close this landfill.
You may.
But no.
But a lot of technology.
So what happens, now I understand you've got 400 or so acres. Do you move somewhere or is it whole, do you have to have a whole new site?
We have a total of 530 acres. 90 acres is approved for landfilling purposes, so the state has already approved 90 acres. Of that 90 acres, we're 37 and a half acres into that footprint. A lot will change. Technology will change. Recycling will change. I believe that we will have an infinite landfill. That's just my take on it. I'm 51 years old, so... You know, what I say may not matter.
He's too young to retire.
75. But I have high mileage. So, we're going to be fine. I would hate to site another landfill now. I don't know if anybody here, I know Commissioner Smith remembers when we sited the Austin Quarter landfill back in the early 90s. It would be impossible to site one now. We can never do it again.
And that's what a lot of other counties, that's why they want to bring their garbage to us.
Because exactly.
They're running into those issues,
sure,
and we've
sure.
made a choice not to do
so, that. So that would, I want to also publicly thank my staff. Pam Long, who's here this morning as administrative officer, she's my third administrative officer. I've worked through two, and I don't want to work through another one. So the writing's on the wall for me. So. Just an excellent job she's done with this budget and gathering data, and my staff has just been tremendous help and support for me.
Now, what is our process? When are you leaving? At the end of the year?
I'm leaving June 1st. I'll be retiring.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, are we in?
We're in the process. We have advertised for the position. We're also working with the landfills engineering firm. To help us look and kind of comb through some of the applications, because there's a lot of technical and environmental certifications that are really needed for the position.
Right.
And we're not qualified to go through and say what's valid and what's not valid. So I'm sorry, I forget his name.
Wayne Sullivan.
Wayne, that's right. So we have met with him, and he's going to submit a proposal also. We believe we're okay to handle the day-to-day operations. However, on the permitting and the reports going back to the state, Wayne's going to help us with those. And so we're going to get the proposal on that. But again, I think the application period for the position has been closed. And now we just need to review the applications that we have and then start the process. So hopefully, July 1, August 1, that time frame, we should have somebody on.
Now, will we be able to consult you on some things as we move
into I'll do anything
this?
I can to help and okay. train, even when I'm off the
floor. You're not leaving. Price, he will.
Yeah, he's not leaving the county, is
he? You can call me. I'll do. This county is very important to me.
Well, thank you.
This county has been good to me.
Let me tell you, young members of this board, if you really want to get the ire of this county up, just tell me, mention the fact you want to sell that landfill. Mm-hmm. It happened back in some time after 2000, and the response was so heavy that the chairman came to me, Larry Sharp, and said, don't ever.
Don't even mention it.
Selling that landfill again.
Or letting somebody bring a piece of trash to it that don't live in Alamance County.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, very good. Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
All right. Now we will take a quick break now that Dr. Harrison is here.
We're
moving fast. We're going to take a quick break.
Greg?
Manager, we're going to start back here, and we're going to have Dr. Harrison make his presentation. Are you doing a PowerPoint? Shelton, or somebody.
Shelton.
Get the lights there a little bit so we can see what you got to say.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to share our budget request for you. Thank you for the consideration. Thank you for the support that you've given us in many ways, not just fiscally. In addition to the fiscal support you provide, we feel that we have you behind us spiritually and with us as we attempt to make this vision that this community developed for public education a reality. I'm not going to go through this, but I just start every conversation I have about ABSS with our vision and what we want to become, and we want to become a model. We want our kids to have opportunities that are unmatched anywhere in the state or anywhere in this nation. We're absolutely committed to that. Everything that we do is driven by that. Our staff developed, prior to my arriving, a solid strategic plan that will help make that a reality. Last year, we were very thoughtful in developing our budget around that plan. We're not just picking a figure out of the sky and saying, let's take this to the commissioners and hope we can get that, or hope we can get half of that, or hope we can get three quarters of that. We're being very thoughtful, very sincere, very transparent about building a budget that will help make that strategic plan a reality. What I presented to you last year, and I will share with you today a little bit, and simply our beliefs, and you've heard that our teaching and instructional leadership, you'll see how our budget is tied to that, and what we've done as we started this process is taking a look at each of these areas and what is it going to take to get there. And I started out saying 5 years, but being realistic, we're saying 5 to 10 years. We backed up last year, which is where we came up with the figure we did last year as a starting point, and we had plans for what our requests were going to be year two. We understood what you did for us last year, and we've kind of scaled back in year two and have not addressed all areas of the strategic plan this year, but I felt that there were a couple of areas that we absolutely couldn't slow down on. And we'll see that as we go through. The big one and our absolute priority is taking care of our teachers. At the end of the day, it comes down to competent, caring teachers working with our children. Our turnover rate is higher than the state average. Last year, about 20% of our teachers who left us moved either east or west to Guilford County or to Orange County or to Durham County. And we made a commitment that over a 5-year period, we were going to have our teacher supplements on par with those counties. That I think we can compete with Orange and Durham and Guilford. I think Chapel Hill is in a world of its own, so we're not even going to go there.
Don't go there.
But we thought last year, when I came to you last year, our supplement was 9% for all of our teachers. We decided that we wanted to keep folks here, so we have a differentiated supplement schedule based on years of experience. So last year we kept our beginning teachers at 9%. We added a percent for our teachers who had 5 to 10 years experience, and we added 2% for our teachers who had over 10 years experience in ABSS. This year we're coming to you asking for a 1% increase for each classification of teachers. So our request would be that our teachers beginning July 1st, 2016, 0 to 5 years, will get a 10% supplement. 6 to 10 years, will get an 11% supplement. And those with 10 years or more, or actually those with 10 more than 10 years, will get an 11% supplement. And you can see that's $818,232.680. The column to the far right is what it will take to fully implement that strategic goal. If we're going to have the very best teachers, those teachers need to be supported. I think salary keeps folks away. It drives some away, but a major factor in driving teachers away is a lack of administrative support. As important as the teacher is, we've got to have a good, strong principal that can recruit, select, develop, and retain the very best teachers. It's any of you in your businesses and your work, you know it costs more to replace employees. You get someone in, you get them trained, and get them kind of up to speed, and they walk out, and then you have to start the process all over. So we think that assistant principals and principals are every bit as crucial to making this happen and to ensuring that our children have the teachers that they deserve. And we're doing the same with our assistant principals and principal supplements, differentiating for assistant principals based on years of experience with us. For our principals, we're differentiating based on the school, elementary schools, middle schools, and high schools. We also have found that our classified personnel have not been dealt with in an equitable manner from the state or by us as a system and a superintendent locally. The past couple of years, classified personnel only received a small bonus. We also realized that our roles and responsibilities for our classified personnel have changed dramatically. And I'm not 100% sure that we're compensating people appropriately for the skill level involved in various positions. Some jobs that may have been higher paying jobs 10 years ago might not require as high a level of skills. So we really have kind of an outdated salary schedule for our classified personnel, and I talked with Mr. Honeycutt about the salary study that he did, and what we want to do this year is to give all of our classified personnel a $200 supplement and then do a classified salary study, which we're estimating to be in the neighborhood of $60,000. And again, that was talking with one who does these studies and talking with the county manager. That's how we landed on that particular figure. So that has to do with strategic goal number one, which is ensuring that we have quality people. The other strategic priority that we simply don't want to slow down on has to do with our specialized programs. We have an A-plus programs, an arts program at North Graham is in year one. And we've been getting very positive reviews on that, and we feel real good about what that's doing in the Graham community. We had one additional immersion global program this year. That was at Eastern. So we now have language immersion global schools at Eastern, Elon, South Graham, and Smith. My goal was to have similar program in each of our six high school attendance zones. We plan to expand to Yoder and Alexander Wilson this year. As our students who are in that immersion program, they begin in kindergarten, and then we in second grade, third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade, then they move on to the middle school. So these students, Mr. Parker, you weren't here last year. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the program, but it's a cohort group of students that begin their kindergarten year and have instruction in a second language. And the second language we're instructing in is Spanish. It's been very successful. So as these students go to the middle school, we need to add some middle school support so we don't just leave them high and dry with second language instruction after 6 years. So 2 years ago we started the middle school program at Western because the Elon program was the first. This year we started the program at Turrentine because the Smith program was the second. Next year we'll start the program at Graham Middle School because South Graham is the third. We've also are looking at the Fire Academy at Graham High School. We've had conversations again with the county manager, the fire marshal, the municipal fire departments and ACC, and we're excited about that opportunity for students, at, not only at Graham, but that's going to be a program that will be open to students in the entire county. Eventually, Graham will become that trade. We hope that Graham will become that skilled trade schools, and the Municipal Academy will be in that program as well. We've had conversations with law enforcement about the following year offering a criminal justice or law enforcement program. We've had conversations with ACC about that as well. We simply think it makes a lot of sense to have a Municipal Services Academy housed in the school that sits in our county seat. We're looking at a Leader in Me program at Andrews and Newland. This is a program that really focuses and emphasizes student leadership development. It's based on the work of Stephen Covey. My goal is, I've talked about those six immersion global programs, but it's also to have six Leader in Me programs and six A-plus arts programs. Again, we want equitable opportunities in all of our elementary zones, and the idea being that if I live in Graham, I have an elementary student, I can choose to send my child to South Graham for the immersion program, or I can choose to send my child to North Graham for the A-plus program, or go to the school to which he or she is assigned. We want to expand the early college. Last year was the first year of the early college. We've had the middle college is grades 11 and 12. The early college, our students start in the on the campus of ACC in the ninth grade. We had 40 students in the program last year, so we'll have 40 rising 10th graders on the campus of ACC. Dr. Gatewood has been very generous with space. We have space for 60 students on the campus of ACC next year, so we've already accepted 60 ninth graders for that program. The downside of that is we had 150 students express an interest and qualify. So while we're accepting 60, we're saying no to 90. And why this is part of our budget process is we would like to begin an early college at Graham High School as well, that we could take a wing at Graham, we could offer the early college experience to those 90 children, and we could work with President Gatewood about the possibility of bringing one ACC instructor onto the campus of Graham to teach the one class, college class, that the students take in ninth grade and then 10th grade. And then when those youngsters reach 11th grade, they would attend school at ACC as part of the general college population. So even those students who are in a facility on ACC campus today as ninth and 10th graders, they're being taught primarily by our teachers. They do have a class with an ACC instructor. When they become 11th graders, they will essentially have finished most of their high school requirements. The high school requirements that they have not finished, they will be able to take as part of the college curriculum. So those students now, they're kind of self-contained in that little classroom section, on the ACC campus. When they become juniors, they're going to be out among the general population of the college. So we think we can accomplish the same thing at Graham High School. We had a public hearing, a redistricting forum at I've been talking about that so much that I do get tongue-tied. It's
which forum?
I'm not sure what it is. I'm just standing up and talking, Commissioner. It's interesting because we had a parent whose child did not get in the program, and it's just based on a lottery once you make the requirement. And she asked, have you considered this? And if so, how long? And I said, well, I'm thinking about it. We have kind of a plan drawn out, and I said, I'm going to be talking with our commissioners, and if things go well, we might be able to offer that this fall. So we're really excited about that. And then the other thing that we want to expand is the virtual academy. Again, this helps us maximize space, because really with the virtual academy, we're allowing students to take courses without showing up on our campus. And a lot of families have kids who need to work, different circumstances. And, you know, schooling can look a whole lot different than I thought it would have to look when I began teaching a few years ago. And so we think that we're making adjustments to meet the varying needs of all the students that we serve. So we're excited about expanding the virtual academy. And the final thing is the Career and College Promise. This is opportunities. Again, ACC is just an absolute wonderful partner that our students, whether they from their home campus have access to ACC courses. In some cases, they go to CTEC for the course. We've expanded this year. We have what we call a fifth period, that after the regular school day is over, an ACC instructor comes to CTEC and teaches our students. Some cases, our students go to ACC during the day. So it takes a number of configurations, but it's just another opportunity for students to get some college credit while they're in high school. And we have some students graduating this year that will be entering a four-year institution as a sophomore, and in some cases as a second semester sophomore next year, because of the opportunities that we've been able to provide through virtual education, through the early college, through Career College Promise. So that's about $702,000. And then our final area that we're looking at is a weighted teacher allocation formula for high poverty schools. We came to you last year, and we simply know that it takes a little bit more to educate some children who haven't had the experiences that we'd like all children to have prior to their entering school. And it can happen, but it takes some extra work to enable those kids to maximize their potential. So what we did last year was we wanted to weight our student, our teacher allocation based on the percentage of students in a school on free and reduced lunch. We began at our four schools with the highest levels of poverty, and we want to expand that a little bit this year. Eventually, we'd like to be able to do that at all of our schools. Again, that's 7, 8, 9 years down the road. So that's our current expense request. The other issue that's a big issue that we're not asking for anything next year, and it's interesting, I meet with what I call our Teacher Advisory Council once a quarter, and those are our finalists and for the Teacher of the Year from the previous year. And I just finished meeting with them before coming here, and we've been very intentional about our technology implementation. And you know, kind of the sexy thing in education now is to have some type of device in the hands of all children. And I think that wonderful things can happen when you have a device in the hands of all children. But a whole lot of school systems and schools have put devices in the hands of all children before teachers were really ready to do anything with that.
Use that.
And so we have all these devices out there that we spent a lot of money, but they're not being used to the fullest capacity. So what we wanted to do, we had a plan. And we said, let's back off a little bit and let's provide professional development and get our teachers in a position where they're asking for this. Not that we're giving it to them and telling them to use it, that they're asking for it because they know how they can use this. They know how it can enhance the instruction and the opportunities for children. So what was interesting today is we've been through a year and three quarters now of professional development, and one of the things that came up from these teachers is, you know, when are we going to get our devices? That we've got teachers out there that have had this training and they're ready to move forward. It's not widespread. We got a grant from the Golden Leaf Foundation, which will purchase about 600 devices. We're getting a real strong inventory on what we have, see how we're using them. We're deploying those devices in a very intentional way that teachers have to submit a request for proposal telling us how they're going to use those devices. And then next year we want to begin on a three-year lease cycle. So what we've done on that one, it's $1.5 million is what that's going to cost for that lease over a three-year period, so $500,000 a year. But that's part of the strategic plan, so I have that up there, but we're not asking for anything on that particular area this year. But I wanted you to know that we're moving forward on that. And again, you can see, and I didn't mention that strategic plan, goal 6, classroom and school supports, and again, they're all related. And then strategic goal 3 is our written 5-year facilities plan. We presented the 5-year facilities plan to our board last month, I believe it was. We shared it with the facilities committee the other day. Mr. Parker, you had a chance to see that. We also announced that the board work session on Monday, that we're working with the department formerly known as Deaner. I can't understand why I can't remember what they're called. to develop a... What is it?
Department of Environmental...
Yeah, Deaner, that's the old name. I don't know. I can't.
Yeah, that's the old name.
It's environmental quality something.
Quality something.
Yeah. But
Department of Environmental Quality.
Quality. DEQ. I can remember DEQ. I can't remember. There's, but we're working with them to really change out most of our lighting, a number of our HVAC and units. And really take care of a lot of things that our facilities task force saw when they visited those schools last year. And so over the years, that can change dramatically. The proposal that we'll have in front of the board, it's 148 pages. It's in draft form. It's going back and forth between DEQ, our office, and the board. We'll have some conversation about that at our board meeting at the end of this month. If we decide that we want to continue to move forward, I will be in front of you as soon as the county manager allows me to talk about that and talk about what implications that has on the commissioner school system relationship. But I think Chairman Boswell and I think Commissioner Byrd were at meetings when we had someone come and talk with us about that. And Mr. Honeycutt has met with those folks and me a couple of times. So that's... again, in a nutshell, that's what we're asking for as far as expansion. You know, we shared with you some significant cuts that we made last year. We're in the process right now of trimming in a couple of other areas where we can. We really believe that we've been very vigilant about looking at our expenditures. We've been very intentional in making sure that the dollars that we're asking for this year, that we asked for last year, are tied directly to what's happening for our students in our schools. Our students in our schools deserve the very best. We can't get from where we are today to where we want to be overnight. We think that we're being reasonable in the pace that we're setting, and we're not where we are because anybody's at fault or anyone's to blame. We've just had tough economic conditions since 2009. We think we're making a turn on that, and again, we want to be cognizant of the difficult decisions that you have. We recognize that there are a lot of us coming before you expressing needs, but I think it all starts with what we do for our kids. At the end of the day, if we want to serve this community well, if we want this community to be the place we all say we want this community to be, and I think we mean that. I truly believe that we want this to be the very best place that it could possibly be. I believe with all my heart that it has to start with how we treat our children. So thank you for the opportunity to present, and I welcome any questions. Any friendly questions?
I'd like to make a couple of comments.
Sure.
And ask a couple of questions, too. Attending the school board's work sessions and the board meetings and going to a lot of functions, I just feel so much energy and excitement about what's going on in our schools. I just think it's fabulous what you're doing. And I'm a big believer in planning, as y'all know, and what you're presenting is really sticking to the plan so that we can achieve that vision that the community came together to create. And earlier today, we were hearing budget requests for DSS, and we were talking about, you know, why do we have so many foster kids, and why are we having, you know, spending a lot of money? And Commissioner Smith asked about, well, how about the home situation? Is that kind of part of the cause? And well, yeah, it probably is. And education, I would say, is the answer. And we heard from the sheriff yesterday about needing more deputies, but how many of those deputies are needed, or how many would go away if all of our kids had the very best education and the opportunity to succeed in life and, you know, graduate and get jobs, and how many, you know, all the social ills that would eliminate. So here we have this great vision and a plan to get us there, and I just think it's really important to stick to the plan. I was going to bring up I remember last year you had come to us, and you had already made all these cuts, and that really helped to keep the overall increase cost burden to the county down. And so I was going to ask where we were. Was there any more places to cut for this year? And I guess you're working on that.
We're finalizing some of those. The places that we've cut have kept that figure where that figure is right there, and I'll be happy to share what some of those areas are when we kind of finalize that.
Well, another question I wanted to ask is, I understand about how it's in North Carolina, it's the county's responsibility to pay teacher pay supplements. And some counties don't pay any, and some pay a lot more than we do. But I guess I'm not fully understanding of, there are certain positions apparently that the entire positions are being paid for by the county. So when we talk about the arts programming, the expansion of, we're adjusting the ratios because of the poverty levels in certain schools. So those extra positions, really the state doesn't help at all with any of those things.
We get our allotment for elementary schools based on 1 to 20.
Yeah, it varies by grade. Yeah.
K-2 is 1 to 18. So we get
moving.
Yeah, they allot it based on numbers of students, but they don't allot for particular areas. So, you know, a legislator asked, well, if we allot teachers based on 1 to 18, why is it that we have so many classes with 22, 23, 24 children in? And it's because school systems can use that allotment for the art teachers, for the music teacher, for the PE teachers. So here it's a combination. Shannon, don't let me go down the wrong path on this. It's a combination of local dollars and state dollars that we pay our art teachers. Remember last year I came to you and asked for dollars for art teachers. I think it was about $400,000 or $500,000 to provide equity between the former city schools and the former county schools. That we had full-time art teachers in the former city schools, but we only had half-time art teachers in the former county schools. And we think we're one system. And so we think that all of our children deserve the same thing. So that was a big issue there. We have some low wealth funding we receive. We use some of that for positions. So it's a combination. The vast majority are state paid positions. We pay the supplements on those. A fair number are low wealth, federal, and local positions. So we pay the whole salary there from a different source, plus the local supplement that we get from you guys.
So the local amount that you're requesting from the county is $40,214,000.
Which is an increase of 10%.
On page 8.
That's current expense and capital.
And capital.
But together.
Yeah.
Right.
And the total budget of the ABSS proposed for next year?
It's $182 million this year. $182 million this year?
Yeah, in that ballpark, yes.
Because you won't know for sure until the state
decides how much you get, right?
Big ballpark.
And I'm just trying to think in round terms, the percent of your overall budget that would be borne by the county is going to be greater than 20%. $40 million of $200,000 would be a fifth or 20%. So it'd be a little more than that. $40 million of 189 or 190 million would be like 20.
Need to get your calculator out of there.
My head's turning.
Yeah, I'm following you.
Okay. And then 40 million of our proposed budget, it's our total.
30%. General fund?
Yeah, it's the general fund.
141 right now.
30.
Yeah, general fund
30% of our budget.
I have to say, I have a grandchild in the immersion program, and he's absolutely loving it.
What grade is he?
Teaching me Spanish. He's kindergarten. So we're counting to 100 now. But that, and also I saw what your proposal is in the trades for. I think you're going to propose doing an electrical program or.
We'll bring people like you and people from the industry in to help us. We have a long list, and I will forward you the PowerPoint presentation that we've used for our public forums, because we have on that, Jenny, probably about
25 different trades, and it'll probably be starting out with 4 to 5 of those tops.
And so what we want to do is make sure we start out with the right ones. And
I think it's very important because being in the building business today, there are hard to find qualified people to do work, and they're not getting the jobs, but the money is there if they learn the trade and can do it.
I've heard that from day one, and we are working. Robin Bowers is our CTE director, is heading that up, and we're working closely with her advisory council as well as ACC.
So career readiness, I think, can start at high school level as well as, I saw Dr. Gatewood pull in, so he's into that business too. But yeah.
I thought he was back there when I was saying all that nice stuff about him.
I missed you.
We got it on tape.
Yeah. Dr. Harrison, I'd like to recognize your board members, Tony Rose, Steve Van Pelt. Thank y'all for
Chairman Van Pelt and board member Rose.
I've got a question about those devices. Do you still have the category like GT or whatever it is, gift and talent in or anything?
They do that. Those change names every 5 years.
Oh, yes. My daughter was
yeah,
one thing.
It's,
but
AIG, academically and intellectually.
Are those the ones that are designated to get those kind of devices, or is it general population?
General population. We, some of our career technical programs have more devices than others. We probably have those for the academically gifted services, but we have classroom sets for general population, just the kids like me that come through school trying to do the best we can. So we want to have those devices in the hands of every child at some point, 3 to 5 years down the road.
You have money in here for help desk whenever they start playing ping pong with them?
It's really interesting, and that's a legitimate question and a legitimate concern. But school systems that have had one-to-one initiatives, even though they may not be using the technology the way you'd want them to be using it, they've not had a problem with vandalism. That those are theirs, they're assigned to them, and they take care of them. You know, you look at the kids who have cell phones, and some of them have their own devices. Their history has been that they take great pride in that, and that was a big concern that everybody had when they started down this path. This is a lot of money, and look what you know, they'll lose their textbooks, but they won't lose these things.
Thank you. I just wonder what it is.
Well, I think, just as a board member, I think this is an economic development issue, because what we do in our schools reflects on businesses that are interested in Alamance County. So hopefully we can work towards doing what we need to with this. Everybody okay?
For my information, a little off subject, how are interscholastic athletics paid, Doctor? Football, basketball, baseball, track, all of that?
We have a...
don't pay any of that, do we?
We do. Some, Dr. Monroe, we have a general athletic fund that we provide. We call it the zonal fund. Do you want to help me with this answer?
Yes. At the beginning of each school year, when Dr. Richardson, we talked about creating funding for the schools, high schools especially. Money is allocated per zone, so on each zone you receive a certain amount of money to use among the schools, and they come together as the principals and ADs for the most part to determine what the need may be and use it for athletic equipment. But the middle schools, because they don't generate enough revenue in the sports they have, we give them a certain amount of money to jumpstart them for the sporting season. So therefore, with the amount allocated for middle schools, in addition to what the zone money received, they have enough to move forward with it in terms of equipment, things like that. So
most of it is generated through their own
revenue flow? Their receipts, yes.
The coaches are paid, I guess, like teachers?
Coaches are paid like us. We have a supplemental coaching supplement as well.
Any more questions, comments? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And I'll remind Dr. Gatewood to mention your name as many times as he needs. Speaking of, not Dr. Gatewood. Okay, Alamance Elder Care, Laura.
external agencies were scheduled, so I appreciate you seeing me this afternoon. I've been with Alamance Elder Care just a short period of time now, just since the end of October. Had been there previously, but as the program director, have just been in there since the end of October. You know, our grant request this year was for $90,000, which was, I think, just under 5% increase from $86,100 last year. At Alamance Elder Care, and you can all read it in the literature that I gave you, we do a lot of programs. And all of our programs are geared for persons 60 years of age or older. We have information and referrals, so we take a lot of phone calls from people looking for assistance about where to find the services, and we do referring folks to those services, and lots of times we actually do a lot of assistance helping them obtain the services that they're looking for. It's no secret that the aging population is growing. 10,000 people in the United States turn 65 each day. In the next just under 15 years, our 60-plus population in this county is going to increase by over 70%. We do what we do with a very small staff. And I like to say when I speak with folks that what our product is our staff. It's our care managers, our administrative assistant. She does a lot of the information and resource and referral that I just spoke about. We have a care manager, one that's dedicated completely to our family caregiver support program. And that provides information, it provides education, it provides a support group, it manages respite care for family caregivers who have a loved one at home. And that causes a lot of stress. If you've ever been a family caregiver, you can understand the amount of stress that causes. I want to tell you a quick story about a client story that we've had in the last few weeks. And it's a little bit different because in this case, the caregiver is over 60 years old, but the care recipient is only in her early 30s. And it came to us because the care recipient has Haw River syndrome, and the caregiver has a brain tumor, but has not received disability, and was really sort of at his wit's end caring for his daughter. We were able to put some respite care in there. We were able to fund some supplies for the bathroom to make it easier for her to have a bath, which had been almost impossible for weeks. So that's the kind of thing that Family Caregiver Support Program does. You're all familiar with the Community Alternatives Program for Disabled Adults. That's the CAPDA Medicaid program. At Alamance Elder Care, we service and manage those clients for the county, for DSS, who are age 60 and over. We currently have probably about 36 clients that we're caring through that program. And we have capacity for 41. But one entire care manager is dedicated to that program. In addition to the family caregiver support and the CAPDA, which is taking up a lot of staff time, we do care management through the Home and Community Care Block Grant. And we provide services to about 8 adults in Alamance County through that grant. But I want to tell you, in the last 4 weeks, it became my charge to kind of clean up that wait list. And as soon as I got that cleaned up, we took in 24 people onto that wait list in the past 4 weeks. And I know there's a whole lot more need out there. People don't know about it. And that's one of our goals, I think, in the coming year is to make sure people do know about the services. We have so many people say, I wish I knew about Alamance Elder Care. Well, we've only been around for 24 years, so I don't know how you missed it, but they do. We collaborate with a lot of agencies in the county, with social services, with the Family Justice Center, and I think that our services add a whole lot to the ability for the hospital to cut down on their readmissions. When we're managing clients, whether it's through the CAPDA program or through care management, we're able to see early on if they're having troubles that might get them back into the hospital, the emergency room. We're able to keep an eye on their medications, make sure they're taking their medications, check in with them, make sure they're taking their blood pressures, get them to the doctor if they need to get to the doctor. And I know I have a short period of time, so let me make sure I've covered all the programs. In the last year, we've started doing what's called options counseling, and that's very different. That's we meet with folks who are 60 years of age or older and just don't quite know what they want for the next 20 years or 25 or 30 years to look like. So we work with them. It's client-centered. We help them. We facilitate them to create a plan for themselves. It's a 90-day period. We walk them through the plan. We make sure that they're achieving their goals, and then we discharge them after that. In addition, we're doing a lot more education out in the community. Our care managers are now certified to teach matter of balance and chronic disease management classes out in the community. So you can see that with a very small staff, we are doing and accomplishing a lot of work. So it's with that I respectfully ask that you would continue to fund us, and we are very grateful to your funding in the past years. Questions?
So the total this year you're looking for is $90,000.
Yes.
Which is up $4,000 roughly from last year. Susan, it says there's not been an audited report. What is that? Tell me a little bit about that, please.
They are in the process of completing their audit, and they have until the end of the year to submit that to us.
Okay, very good.
Our last audit completed was for 2014.
Okay.
So your fiscal year is what? It's the calendar year?
The calendar year is our fiscal year, but then we have different fiscal years based on grants. The state is July 1 through...
The federal is September 30th.
Correct. Yeah. It gets a little confusing.
It sure is.
But it's great service for the community. Thank you for your hard work.
I've been on that board, I don't know how many years, probably.
You're going to be definitely in the elder care.
That's true.
but
they do work very hard and provide a great service. In fact, the elder care was started out of a study done by the County Planning Committee for Services for the Elderly. Is that the name of it? When they identified the need for kind of being that central point that people can call in to figure out how to navigate the system as people as
and it's
age
complicated. And as you get older, it gets more complicated. Without a doubt. Any more comments, questions? Thank you very much.
Appreciate your time. Thank you.
All right. Last but not least, Dr. Gatewood, you're ever doing a lot of digging in your books there. I don't know. That scares me.
Means he's not prepared.
Is that what it is?
Talk
either
about
that, or he's thinking we're being generous today, and he's going to ask.
No, actually, I'm trying to prepare for the test, and you are the test. Good afternoon.
Well,
thank you. I have with me today Ms. Cindy Colley, who is our Vice President of Administrative Services and Chief Financial Officer. And as you are aware, we are here to make our budget requests. But before we get into the numbers, I would like to share with you just a few things about the college. And by the way, it's great to see all of you, Commissioner Byrd, Commissioner Parker, Chairman Boswell, Commissioner Massey, and my good friend, Commissioner Smith. It's great to see
good
all
to
of
see you.
See you,
Doctor.
Thank you, sir. Next week, and this just gives you some insight as to how much we have going on at Alamance Community College. Next week, we will be very, very busy. We will have our groundbreaking for the new Advanced Applied Technology Building, and that will be on May 17 at 2:30 p.m., and hopefully you have all received your invitations. I am proud also to report to you that Acting Chair Boswell will be making comments on behalf of the Commission, as well as Commissioner Smith, who was the chairman of this board when those funds were approved. So we're looking forward to your presence there. We hope to have a great day. You know, usually groundbreakings don't generate a lot of people or population, but my hope and vision is that we'll have some 200 people present for this groundbreaking. That's just how excited we are about it.
You want me to stand at the raid and run?
Absolutely, Ms. Massey, and I'll stand there with you okay. until the program
we
begins.
We might have the sheriff just block the interstate right past that, so they have to come.
Very good idea. I'll have to talk to Sheriff Johnson about that. And then on Friday of next week, we will celebrate our commencement program, which is one of the most favorite times for me. We will have in excess of 700 graduates participating wow. in that program. We're so proud of what we do, and speaking of proud, I'm overjoyed that Alamance Community College is ranked number one in the state. There are 58 community colleges in this state, and we're ranked number one for enrollment growth for the year 2015-16. That's a projected growth of 6%, and after three iterations, it still remains at 6%. So this, I think, speaks to the hard work that the faculty and staff are doing and the outreach that we're doing to with the community and the great educational quality that we provide at a reasonable price. Our culinary arts program is, as my siblings and I would say, is off the chart. They won the state competition for hot foods. They went down to Atlanta. Now, in the state competition, they didn't only have in the contest community colleges, but they competed with places like Johnson and Wales, but they still reigned number one. They went down to Atlanta for the regional, Southeast regional competition, and won number one again. So now they will go to Arizona, Phoenix, Arizona in July to compete for the national title. And we're hoping and praying that they will come back with that title. And if they don't come back with a title, we're still going to be very proud of them. Now, here's another exciting thing. We just introduced our first debate team. And they went over to, I think it was Durham, North Carolina, and competed with a number of debate teams, including four-year colleges and universities. And we didn't win first place. But for first year, we beat out High Point University. And if you know Nito Cabin, he's on TV all the time.
You didn't bother to call him
yes,
right after that.
Exactly. He's always talking about how excited he is with High Point and what all the things he's doing. I hope he talks about that. Nito is a person that I have come to know recently. I can't wait to see him again. Miss Collier, you on the slides?
Sure.
Okay, thank you. So the college, Mr. Parker, I'm not sure that if you are aware of this, but I think most of the others of you are. But the college opened in 1958. We're 58 years old. So we're becoming of age. Now, I can't say that it has reached my age yet, but it's on its way. It is a maturing institution. We offer in excess of 30 curriculum programs, ranging from nursing to automotive technology to computer integrated machining, business administration, computer networking, and a large array of other programs, college transfer being one of the largest of all of the curriculum programs. We also have a continuing education area that offers training that is non-degree training. You can earn some certificates in some of the training, and it's generally short-term, and it is doing well also. The continuing education program also includes occupational extension, and that's when we go into the workplace, into industry, and help incumbent employees upgrade their job skills and help them become certified in various areas and obtain licensure. But here's what I think you might find very interesting. About 74% of all of the enrollment in continuing education is in the area of law enforcement, emergency medical services, and fire protection. Emergency services area comprises almost 74% of that enrollment. So that means that the probability is extremely high that if you have a need to call an ambulance or an EMT person or someone from Sheriff Johnson's office, there's a high probability that you will interface with a graduate of Alamance Community College. Let's talk about a few milestones. As previously mentioned, we'll have the groundbreaking on the new Advanced Applied Technology building next week. And let me just say that in that building, we will have machining, heating, ventilating, air conditioning technology, automotive mechanics, welding, And the newest program, and this is in my notes further, so I may repeat it or skip over it. The newest program on our college, at our college, in 16 years, and that's mechatronics. And mechatronics is a blend of mechanical, computer, engineering, and it is going to feed, it already is feeding our new apprenticeship program, which is the Career Accelerator program. And that is a partnership between several of our key industries here, the Chamber of Commerce and Alamance Burlington School System. I really don't know what Dr. Harrison said about me, if anything, but I will say now, and I'll probably say later, how important his partnership is. We could not, as a county, we would not have this apprenticeship program without ABSS. But by the same token, we wouldn't have it without ACC either. Right. And this is how we build our community and prepare for the 21st century jobs, and how we ensure economic viability of this county is by providing people with the skills they need to get good paying living wage jobs. And that's so important. You've heard about our Biotechnology Center of Excellence that's been under development. Well, we hope to launch that in the very near future. It is my hope to have the final presentation, which would be the more specific proposal, presented to the Board of Trustees in June. So hopefully we can launch that program in the fall of 2016. We're in the early stages of developing an associate degree in engineering. That will pay dividends in the type of work that seems to be finding its way here to Alamance County and the type of employment. We're also in the process, and Commissioner Byrd, I think you will appreciate this, of starting a program in histology. And that is the study of cells and human tissues. I'm happy to report that we will have this year our first graduating class from ACC through a partnership with the University of North Carolina Greensboro in nursing. So students will be graduating with a Bachelor of Science in Nursing, and they will have gotten it right at Alamance Community College. Our staff are very excited. Not only can you feel their excitement, their excitement is paying off. We just had the most successful faculty staff retiree campaign to raise money for our foundation to help students in the history of the college. In excess of $55,000. That's a lot of money for a school the size of Alamance Community College. And so that's just really great. Partnering in higher education, let me just mention, I talked about the UNC Greensboro and the nursing program. But we also have a relatively new partnership with Guilford College that allows our students to transfer there and enroll and matriculate at a cost that is supposed to be equivalent or about the same as one would have if they went to a public university, which is a good deal. Now, I talked to one of our students who actually made the transfer, and she expressed to me that the cost there was about the same as it was at Alamance Community College. And that's at Guilford College. We have six different pathways that we've developed with A&T State University, primarily in the School of Science and Technology, to offer specific transfer opportunities for our schools. And the chancellor there has implemented a $1,500 scholarship for every community college student who transfers to A&T State University. We're doing similar things, Commissioner Massey, with North Carolina Central University, your alma mater. In fact, we've had meetings, and we're in the final stages of drafting what the articulation agreement will include, and it would be centered around opportunities for our students to transfer in childhood development, culinary arts, hospitality, and computer information technology. And finally, the nanoscience technology and engineering school in Greensboro. The actual name is the Joint School of Nanoscience and Nanoengineering. It's so difficult I can hardly articulating.
Sounds like a hard
It is hard. And if you do a tour of that facility, you will find that they're doing some fascinating things there, from studying age to doing various kinds of studies to discern whether or not different music will affect learning in different ways. And they have microscopes larger than my car to see things that we can't see with our naked eyes. That's just how fascinating it is. And so we have this partnership now where students from Alamance Community College will be able to go over there, they're our students, and have paid internships while they participate in testing various materials. So they're going to learn on the job, and if this works like a lot of other internships, they'll end up working there or continuing their education through the Joint School of Nanoscience, which is a partnership between A&T State University and the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. ABSS partnership. How I wish that Dr. Harris was here right now. Harrison was here. He's not here, so if you would share with him the good things I said about his work. I don't know where we would be with our work with ABSS had it worked not for him and his staff. They have been very cordial and cooperative, and they get this message about our desperate need to prepare our people for 21st century jobs, to prepare our people to become taxpayers and not tax takers, to help us improve the quality of life here. With that said, we have a 64, 67, maybe close to 70% increase in the number of students who are participating via Korean College, the Korean College program, which allows for students to take college courses while they're in high school, free of charge, and to really make that connection between high school and college. And that's so critical that we create a continuum of education so that students can see that there is opportunity and that once they get into this pipeline, they continue to move forward. But through that program, this year we enrolled 560 students. And that is a lot of students. We have a special group that is in computer integrated machining. And this program is aimed at building a pipeline of highly skilled workers for local industries in the machining area. We have the early college program that we started last fall. So we're completing our first year with 39 students. We'll add 62 more students to that next year, 60 more students to that next year. And here's a point that I am just terribly excited about. Last year we had one or two students from ABSS that completed a certificate or an associate degree by the time they finished high school. This year, we have 62 students from ABSS that will be recognized for a credential. 32 will receive certificates. I'm gonna get my notes right here. Let me just say that there is a huge number. Here we go. 62 students all total. 16 students will receive their associate degree.
Yeah, they're
high school students. Will walk out of high school with an associate degree. 14 will complete the associate in arts pathway with 32 college credits. And they can transfer that to a public university. 32 hours done. And the 16, 2 years done. They walk in as juniors. And 32 will receive career and technical certificates, certifying them ready to go to work. It could be in criminal justice, accounting, computers, horticulture, web technologies, culinary, medical assistant, advertising and graphics, cosmetology, automotive systems. That is something that you, I hope you are proud of. Community partnerships. The truth is, I'll make this very short. We're partnering with business and industry all over this county, some of which I've already spoken to you about, with ABSS, with the Burlington Housing Authority, the Piedmont Regional Transportation Authority, Burlington Link Transit, and that will begin in June. We can't wait. my guess is that the traffic would be relatively light during the summer, but I suspect that we will have one of the largest fall enrollments that we've seen in a long time, because people will be able to get to the college beginning this fall. Lastly, it's not lastly, but I'm almost done, trust me. I'll talk just for a minute about the impact of Alamance Community College on this county. We had this organization that studied all of the community colleges in the state and the public universities, and they are one of the most renowned data-crunching organizations in the nation. It's called EMSI. That stands for Economic Modeling Specialists International. And they did an assessment of what takes place here in this county for us, and here's what they reported, that the economic impact on Alamance County produced by ACC is $200 million per year. $200 million per year. And for every $1 that is invested in this college, the return on that investment is $4.50. Another way to spend that would be 450% investment, return on investment. If my 401k was doing that, I can't promise you that I would be standing here making this presentation. 450% return on investment. So I think the key here is that you are making a tremendous investment in this county, but you also are getting a tremendous return. And that $200 million equates to 4,865 jobs. Almost 5,000 jobs, and that's in any given year. So the request we have coming before you, and Cindy will make the dollars and cents request on my behalf and the college's behalf, It's major, it's significant. It's a big number. Now, we know that the county's budget has some limitations, but we believe that it is our duty to make clear to you what our needs are, whether you feel them or not. You need to know what our needs are. So part of this is to share with you what we need. And of course, when you provide our award to us, I don't know if this is a good negotiating strategy or not, but we're going to be very pleased with it and go do the best that we can to serve the people of Alamance County. So at this time, I present to you Ms. Colley, Cindy Colley, who will speak about the financial piece of this. Ms. Colley.
Thank you. Okay. Well, good afternoon, commissioners, and thank you so much for the opportunity to come and speak. Again, my name is Cindy Colley. I have the longest title at the college, I like to say. I'm Vice President of Administrative and Fiscal Services and the Chief Financial Officer. So just say the girl with the longest title. So what I'm going to do is just walk you through our request. Of course, you have it in front of you. Dr. Gatewood gets to talk about all the cool and really interesting things we're doing, and I get to talk about the numbers. I guess that's what I get for being a CPA
and
the career path I followed. I talk about the numbers. So, but here we go. Just first, a little college snapshot for you. We have 27 buildings on campus. That's including our main campus and our Dillingham campus, which is in Burlington. Soon to be 28 with the addition of the Advanced Applied Technology Center, or as we call it, the AATC, which we are breaking ground on this month. Very excited. These 27 buildings comprise approximately 400,000 square feet in buildings, soon to be again 455,000 square feet, because the AATC will be 55,000 square feet of space for our five programs that are going into that building. We are getting as much as we can out of that building and that area, and that the money and the funds that you have graciously provided for us. Also, total campus land is approximately 140 acres. In prior years, we reported 90 acres. We have 140 now. We had a land donation of 47 acres that we are now looking into using for our programs. in the fall, we're actually going to start using it with our horticulture program, but that's not going to be limited just to our horticulture program. We're going to do a study to see how we can best use those 47 acres. So in essence, our acreage went up 50%, but we have to take care of, but we're very, very pleased that we had that. Our personnel, that's supported by county funds, of course, two full-time grounds people, employees, one full-time public safety officer, public safety director, and then approximately 16 part-time public safety officers. Just to highlight our request, again, the numbers. Current expense, we've asked for a little over $3.1 million, a neat $200,000 increase over the prior year. Our capital outlay, we've asked for a little over $1.9 million. The big part of that is for phase two of our HVAC project for our 40-year-old HVAC in the main building of our main campus. So that's the big piece of that, for a total of a little over $5 million. And this is my favorite slide. How did we use what you were gracious to give us, our appropriation last year, what we've accomplished with the funds that you provided? In fiscal year 2016, we were able to install a new voice over internet phone system. We had a VoIP system, as it's called. We had a 20-year-old phone system on both campuses that kept breaking down, leaving us suspended one time for 2 weeks during the summer during registration, which was just awful. That's the best word you can use. It was terrible. So that we spent $240,000 on that, which was in our request last year. We completed that project. The second item is we just completed replacing our 40-year-old water line, main water line for the main campus. We had consistent water line shutdowns that, of course, interrupt school operations. You can't have your school open if you don't have water. Of course, it affects our daycare. We used $216,000 in county funds and $300,000 in state funds to replace that water line. That was a very expensive project, but very happy that we have that complete. We finalized, number three, third bullet point, we finalized a comprehensive facilities master plan, 71 pages, with a 10-year plan for our college. Then the next bullet point, of course, we continue to make modernizations to our campus safety, just the environment we live in, continue to install new campus call boxes, upgrades to cameras and radio communications, and we also installed locks, new locks on over 100 classroom doors, which is starting our rekeying process, rekeying project for the campus. And of course, the next to the last bullet, we were able to provide a 2% raise and a one-time $750 bonus for county-funded employees that was comparable to what state employees were provided this year. So we like to treat them equally. And a building A, last bullet point, building A valve replacement, the HVAC system, $36,000 valve replacement. We now have much better control over classroom temperature. It was almost every week I had a student in my office complaining about the temperature, so I'm very glad to say I don't have that anymore. So thank you very much. So our current expense request for this year, asking for, again, an increase of $200,000. The first part is just salary, essentially just salary and benefits, adding two full-time public safety employees. We have one full-time public safety employee, and then the rest of our public safety employees are part-time. So you can imagine, we have a lot of turnover. We have a lot of our, for example, BLET students that come and work in our security, but as soon as they get a job, they're gone. So we're looking to transition some of those part-time positions into full-time, so we'll have some consistency in our public safety department. Again, asking for another full-time grounds personnel and general salary and benefit increases, which is the next to the last bullet point. The state of North Carolina, well, the community college system is asking the General Assembly for a 3% increase for all state employees, and again, we like to be comparable with our county employees, try to give them that same raise, treat them equitably. The last item, increase a plant operation for $16,248. We want to make some improvements to our campus communication center to increase some staffing, to have communication staff there for nights and weekends. Currently, we only do that from 8 to 5. And as you can see, all the wonderful things Dr. Gatewood's talking about, we have people there at night now. We have people on campus on the weekend. And so we feel like we need to have more coverage at our communication center to ensure everyone is safe when they are on campus. And, okay, the capital request. Again, the big item is the HVAC system. Again, we have had to split this up into phases. We've had an engineering firm, contracted with an engineering firm through the state construction office that did a study. This whole project will cost $3.5 million, but we split it up into four phases. The first phase is underway. We have selected a contractor. The second phase is what we're asking money for, which is the $1.3 million. Second item is an additional $175,000 for some backup generators for our IT department. And then again, just general campus maintenance, keeping up with our HVAC, repairs to our chiller, those type of items. And then I put water line replacement is done, $0. We're completely done with that project. And the next increase, protect life and property items. We have replace interior stairway in our B building that still needs to be replaced to meet current code. Again, this project's been on the list for quite a while, but other projects have taken priority, so we've had to put it, push it back. So that's come to the forefront this year. And then again, some more campus safety improvements for approximately $74,000. And again, campus maintenance under protecting life and property. We've got handrails and sidewalks that need attention paid to them, again, for the safety of students, faculty, and staff. Again, I kind of have a theme here, safety. I keep going back to that. We've just got a lot of aging things that we need to pay some attention to this year. You don't really think about handrails, but we've got some that are loose and coming up and paint peeling, so just need to pay a little attention to those. Last slide is just, we always talk about FTE, that's how we're funded through the state. Just have a figure there of the county funding per full-time equivalent student for fiscal year 2016. It's actually $680. Actually, I think that's 2015, I apologize. 2016 figure is $718. With the increased give that you gave us last year, we went way up from 680 to 718, so thank you very much for that. And then college goals, strategic plan, again, facilities master plan, we approved that in January 2016, 10-year plan for the college. And the next two items, improving signage and exploring need for improving signage and or road presence. That was something that was identified in our facilities master plan. Do we need a sign to say, hey, here's ACC, or better presence from I-85, and then also the next bullet point, explore the need for off-campus locations. Those are both addressed in the facilities master plan, so we hit those two items with the, again, with the FMP. And then again, the strategic plan, last item, the Advanced Applied Technology Center, we are breaking ground this month with expected opening for fall 2017. I will turn it back over to Dr. Gatewood, but any questions on the numbers?
I had one on the North Carolina Connect bond.
Yes.
Where is that money ending up?
We are currently, in Dr. Gatewood.
We're in the process now of we're in the process of deciding how best to use that so that we can maximize the benefit of those dollars. The board went through a works process during their retreat recently, and they came up with various ideas, and so we're honing that down to a few that we can manage. My guess is that to the extent possible, we may use some of that for backfilling, you know, move out of the facilities that we have. And,
right.
And when the faculty and staff and students occupy the Advanced Applied Technology Center building, then we'll have to retrofit that space. So that's probably going to be where some of it will go. Mm-hmm.
Well, Dr. Gatewood, you went through a facilities master planning process.
Yes.
And you were kind enough to invite me to participate in some of those sessions, and which I thought was a very, very excellent process and very thorough.
Thank you.
I'm not sure where it ended up, but you must have way more than $6 million worth of projects in the pipeline with respect to facilities.
The facilities master plan, and seem to feel free to correct me this time in public, came out to be about $58
million. $58 million.
And now I want to explain that that would add square feet within the existing footprint enough for us to double the enrollment over time. And it's projected that we'll be able to double the enrollment, and we'll need that square footage. What I think is interesting about this whole scenario is, prior to doing the facilities master plan, our records stated that to go beyond the Advanced Applied Technology building, we'd have to go someplace else and acquire a new property. So this is a blessing that we'll be able to double the square footage and not...
Where was the land donated? Where is that?
It's on Jim Minor Road.
Okay.
It's about 6 miles from campus.
So it's real convenient to the campus right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
The primary use of that land will be for horticulture. And I think we can expand that for agricultural sciences, perhaps. Not as a program, maybe as a program. We're not sure yet. And then with the Biotechnology Center of Excellence, I can see where there'll be some opportunity there as well. We also have the Animal Science Program that you don't hear much about. It's a very popular, very strong program. So that would give them some opportunity to grow as well.
Great.
On the Facilities Master Plan, what sort of time horizon is that thought of to cover? Sure.
It's for 10 years.
10 years.
10 years. Well, 10 plus years, but 10 years. 10 years of phasing. It was very neat how they phased the projects. To do this, you have to do this, that type of thing. And one of the, in the first phase is the backfill retrofitting, of course, with the programs moving to the AATC. So, of course, as Dr. Gatewood stated, we have to pay some attention to that, of course.
I believe it has five stages, which means that not in any given stage would all the pressure, financial pressure, be on us as a county at one time.
I personally want to thank you. I got a granddaughter starting at Duke Hospital next week doing some nursing, so she's been in the nursing program there at ACC, which was her parents. It would have been very hard for them to have put her in another type of program. Right. She started in high school, had credits, and then next week she goes to Duke to start working in the hospital. Hopefully she will keep herself up enough to maybe get in a Duke nursing program.
Great, and I hope she enjoyed her experience.
Yeah.
You know, that's another interesting point about the college. Students, as well as faculty and staff, I've already talked about faculty and the $55,000. I mean, that's indicative of their happiness, if you will. But students seem to really love being on the campus. Let me just give you two quick stories. One is this young man that I've seen on campus, but I'd never really met until today. I was leaving my car, coming back into G building from lunch, and this student, I could tell from his body language, he was coming toward me in a happy way. And he said, I'm finishing up with my classes, and I'll come back in the summer to take another, and then I'll be finished. And I'm in graphic design. He said, I just love this college. I just love this college. So it's almost like he really would be kind of sad to leave and go to work. The second story is, and I may be getting having the horse, the cart ahead of the horse a bit here, is today we had two students through our CLAP, I'll just call it, it's a competition for business. And students have been working on this, and teams of students have been working on this for months and months. And the grand prize is going to be $10,000 that that student can use to build her business. Now, I am ahead of the card. Media, cut me some slack, please. Just a little bit. It'd be great if the campus really presented this, but I was at the competition today. It was so exciting. What is the name of the program that comes on TV?
Shark Tank.
It's very similar. Very similar to Shark Tank. More academically oriented. So this young student now has some resources to help her develop her business plan and a business model for, it's a ninja type of athletic exercise facility. I asked her, what do you do for old people like me? And she said, well, they got people 80 years old that can do this. So it gives me hope.
Just roll you around.
Yes. You didn't ask for all of that, but it's just hard to
it's
hold back.
It's exciting, though,
exciting
isn't
things
it?
That are going
it is.
On. Yes.
Very good. All right. You got any more you'd like to add?
Mr. Boswell, chair, acting chair?
I'm actually chairman.
Boswell. Thank you. Congratulations. Members of the commission, thank you so very much. Mr. Parker, I look forward to getting to know you better.
Yes, sir, I do so.
I guess you can say, a relationship with all the other members, and I hope to have the same with you, sir.
And we look forward to your groundbreaking next week.
Yes, please be there.
Right.
I should add that we have, and this is not to put you to work, this is all symbolic, but we have shovels for each of you so you can participate.
I'm going to throw my paper away.
We look forward to having you there. We do have shovels for you.
Thank
so
you.
You can be part of the ceremony.
I'll be there.
Thank you so much.
Very good. All right. With that, I guess we will wrap it up for the day. Anything you want to add, Susan?
The only thing I wanted to bring out was there had been a question concerning the percent of budget that Alamance County gave to ABSS. Based on our current request, it is 27% of our budget, 21% of theirs, and in retrospect to Alamance Community College, it's 3% of requested.
3-3, okay.
What was that last time?
3-3 for the community. It's 3% of our budget and 3% of their budget.
27-21, 3-3.
We're just really
sad.